Behind the mountain, I'm gonna hide. Behind the mountain, I'm gonna hide. Behind the mountain. Ministers. I feel
closer to being Billy Graham tonight than I ever felt.
All right, man.
I was 10 years old. I met Billy Graham. Helped crusade and that's where I've been several times up through the 80s, and that's what I always wanted to be. I was like Billy Graham, especially upon the helicopter coming down and getting off the platform, taking off to the Birmingham airport, riding that jet and all. So tonight, I just got here. Came straight off that plane. My mom called me and asked me, said, why are you late? I said, because you and Tommy didn't send y'all a plane. I was always bragging. And I got a private plane. I had to wait for Delta. I didn't own Delta. I was just riding. And I couldn't leave till they said so. I was that plane. Airport in Detroit. 4:11 o'clock. They just kept delaying and delaying and delaying. So finally, it took off. And I thank God for keeping it safe. Amen. With Trump in the White House, you never knew what's going to happen. I don't know whether they put a real on shoot first or second or third or what. But I know one thing, Trump trying to get him to shoot. Doing everything to detract from the fact that he had the election. Kind of like Bush when he was selected rather than elected. All of a sudden we had 9/11. And that ended the Constitution's debate about what to do with him. So Mr. Trump, before this Constitution's debate on what to do with him, once he was solidly claimed that he had the election, he want to have something going because you know nothing to make close allies like outside enemies. So they're working very hard to get us a strong outside enemy. I mean, here, we were in Vietnam in the 60s. We fought right along with Klansmen and everybody else. But because that Viet Cong was on the other side, y'all became buddies. Sort of like on these football teams. These boys playing for Alabama, they're good friends on the field. When you walk off the field, it's a different story. I'm glad to be here. Glad to see you in church so early. Amen.
Amen.
That is really good. Because while when I was coming up, I started doing the Bibles when I was 12 years old. We would sit on the porch and wait till it jet about down. Now we better go on down to the church. It just didn't stop for God. We're just glad to be here tonight. I want to talk for a few moments about you need a friend. You need a friend. Call on me. Lean on me. You can count on me. I'll be your friend. Everybody needs a friend.
Yes, sir.
In your next Bible reading, read that little book called Micah. Then read in the second Chronicles, that first chapter. It is better to walk with a friend in darkness than to walk alone in the light. You just feel better when you got somebody with you. I wish I had some help. Now you just feel better. You're going into strange territory, you're moving about. Just to have somebody with you.
All right.
Somebody know what I'm talking about.
Yes,
well, let me say it like this. Adam had everything, but he didn't have nobody. So God had to halt his progress into man's humanity and stop Adam and get somebody to be with him. Yeah, somebody could be my witness. The greatest gift you can give a person is friendship. A lot of folk give you rumors and dimes, but never give you that friendship. A lot of folk are willing to give you material things that and are going to fade away, but never give them their friendship. The greatest gift you can give to anybody is friendship, and the greatest gift you can receive from anybody is friendship. It's sad to go through life without a friend.
Yes, sir.
Somebody has said friendship is one mind and two bodies. It's good to have somebody who can hurt with you when you hurt. Rejoice with you when you rejoice. Can I get a witness here? Your friend. You can tell your friend from your enemy because your friends hurt when you hurt. Your friends rejoice when you rejoice. And it's nothing like having somebody that your happiness is equal to their happiness. They can't be happy when you're sad, and they will be mad when you're happy. You do know that folk like that, don't you? Folk are glad to see you mad. Folk get mad when you're happy. But if you got somebody, in a different body, but with the same mind, they get happy when you get happy. Well, these sayings, good sayings, they're from great minds and famous people, and they carry a lot of weight and seriousness about people and the importance of friendship. The truth is, having a friend is a weighty matter. Uh-huh. Yeah, it is. But then I want you to think. Think of the sorrow of the rich and famous. Think of the sorrow of those folk who made it. Think of the pain of the folk who got everything and got to always work. Do I have a friend? You think of it. I remember one time Dick Clark asked James Brown, said, "Mr. Brown, is there anything you want in life? So you have radio stations, restaurants, hit records, jets, buses, all this fame, you're rich. Is there anything you want?" He said, "Well, if I could have one true friend and know it." You're not here. You're not looking me out. I talk about all these things, about the importance of friendship, but then it's a painful thing. It's a weighty matter because you go out of life thinking, who is really my friend? Yeah. The more you have, the harder it is to take. Well, I'll give you an example of Jesus Christ. So why y'all following me? Uh-huh. You're following me for me or is it the fish and the Lord?
Right.
Okay. Even with Jesus Christ, he had to stop and wonder, why are you following me? Why are you with me? Is it me or what you can get from
me? All right. God
bless you. Boy, that's a painful spot to be in. Just think how painful it must have been to be Michael Jackson. Glory, hallelujah. Think how painful it must have been to be Elvis Presley. Think how painful it must have been to be Prince. And all these people with fame who folk gather around them every day, and they don't know whether the folk are there for them or for the things that they can get from being around them. Oh, you remember the OJ trial.
Yes, sir.
You had a friend testifying against him. He was supposed to be a very close friend. He took the stand and said how low down OJ was and how he would beat his wife, how he scoffed his children. The man said, "Well, why don't you hang around?" And he said, "Well, I enjoyed the cocaine and the women. I enjoyed the pool party. So I took a beach for him just to be there to get the things he was giving out." Very powerful man said to me one time, he said, "Bob, I tell you this, some people like me because I'm a man. Few people like me because of me. So I have to be careful about the blessings that fall past out. I don't have but a few great fans, and I want to give up to people who are going to be with me when I'm not mad. And not just people who, once I'm not mad, they transfer their Lord to who? Yeah, the next man is. It's a painful state of life to have to go through wondering who is my friend. I believe, and believe in my heart, I believe that only God can make friends for you. Carlotta, if you got a friend, it's because God gave it to you. If you got a friend, it's because God gave you that friend. And the only way to have a friend is to get it from God. Jesus said, I love to really call you friend. I said, the only way, there's no other way to have a friend except through God. If you got one friend, you can say, thank you, God. Each morning, the class when I rise, I pray and ask God, Lord, show me my friends on one hand and my enemies on the other hand. Don't let me think that an enemy is a friend. Please don't let me mistake a friend for an enemy. I need you to tell me who my friends are. I need you to reveal them. I need you to uncover those who are being deceitful and wait no stronger. Show me who my friends are. Don't let nobody have to tell me. Let me hear and see for myself. I need to know who's my friend.
Amen.
Friends, they're the siblings that God gave you. Your parents can give you kin, but only God can give you friends.
Amen.
Only God can make friends for you. You see, the truth is, brother, there are husband and wife who've never been friends.
All right. Yeah.
They've been married 35 or 40 years, and they got license, and they stay together in the same house, but they're not friends. I wish I had a witness here. They're sisters and brothers. They got birth certificates with the same daddy and mama name on it. They've got the county stamp on it. But they're really not sisters and brothers because they're not friends. If you want to be a husband and wife, the first thing you need to be is you want to be sister and brother, first thing you need to be was a friend. And I'm here to tell you that license can't make you a friend. You have to take a birth certificate to make your friends. Only God, you. Yeah. Somebody know what I'm talking about. Somebody know that it takes God. Yes, sir. I make you a friend. You need Him. You need Him to make friends for you. Well, some people, however class they confuse buddies with friends.
Amen.
Difference in buddy and a friend.
Amen.
Buddy, you got to walk lockstep with. Buddy, you got to do the same thing at the same time every time you want to do that. Whenever you just pop up and just want to do something else different, you risk losing that buddy.
Amen.
You got to agree with that buddy that says lunchtime, you got to be home.
Amen.
It's time to go, you got to go.
Amen.
You got to think about their plan and agree with what they agree on. If you don't, they'll break up with you. But one thing about a friend, they allow you to be you.
Yeah.
I wish I had some help on
that. Amen.
If that person's not your friend, but they got to be just in lockstep and agreement with you. You know, sometimes folk wonder why folk don't want to be around you. Well, the reason some folk don't want to be around you is because they know they got to walk on eggshells.
Yeah.
They got to be careful what they say, how they say it, what you It's a different than a buddy and a friend. Buddies, buddies. That's a sad thing to have a buddy. It's really sad to be somebody's buddy. You never bloom, just a bud. You start blooming, you gotta get away. But once somebody's your friend,
all right.
Well, I know because Jesus is my friend. And I've messed up so many times. But when I got back to Jesus, he didn't treat me like I messed up. I broke stride. He just said, come on. You need a friend.
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir. Well, let's just say something about the text for a moment. And I'll leave you. Thank you for being here and being here on time. Micah 7 and 5 is earth shaking. It just messes up all the things that have been said about the importance of a friend.
Right.
It just tears the whole matter up about even needing a friend. Because Michael said, listen, he said, don't trust no friend. Don't have confidence in no neighbor. Don't even trust the one you sleep with every night. I looked it up in other translations. I thought perhaps King James was too hard, a little too brash. But in every translation, I searched one after the other, even the NIV was supposed to be so liberal. It just said the same thing. You can't trust nobody. Glory, hallelujah.
Well,
you want to trust somebody. But you can't trust nobody. Even the one that sleeps with you every night, be careful. Don't tell them too much. So whatever you do with the one you sleep with, guard your mouth. Glory, hallelujah.
Amen.
Michael just messed his whole matter of friendship. Well, look at you need a friend, you got to have a friend. It's so important to have a friend. And then for Michael to turn around and say, no! Hold stop! Don't put your trust in nobody. Yeah, somebody thank you.
Yes, sir.
You don't need to be surprised, man. You don't know what you would do. So you sure don't know what other folk would do. Help me now, help me. You can't handle yourself. So you know you can't handle other folk. I went to Detroit some years ago, and they used to have these anniversary things, but it was such a complicated thing. After 2 years, I cut it out. I said, just give me a little anniversary every Sunday. But you know, the last 2 years, we had to collapse. All people got laid off and all this kind of stuff. So I told y'all, I got to start that anniversary thing back. It's been too long. It's been 33 years. So I'm going to happen. Well, then about rhythm, my surprise and my journey, just turned back in, put it together, and it was real nice. And the committee wanted to wait till the next day to make presentations. I said, all right, however y'all want to do it, just as long as you do it. So the next day, I went, but I made a mistake. I took my white ribbon. So there were five different sources, and one got to Reverend Smith. This envelope won't give it to you, this is from me, and that and the other. Here's how much in it, and gave it to me. Next one. And I left out of there really, really happy, but my wife was with me. I got ready to go to bed, and she said, you know what, travel all the furniture. Because all of a sudden, the bed, everything got messed up. Sofa wasn't shaking like nothing. Dining room table, that's the table. All the friends, listen, I was supposed to be a vegetarian. I ate six slices of cheese and four wieners before I knew I was eating meat. I didn't know how to do that, but I did it. And I was in total shock. The good chef didn't have it. So when other folks do things,
yes, sir.
I wish somebody could help me. But this is what Jesus said. It's better to trust God than even to confidence in man. And whoever that person is, you just got to be ready to forgive and forget. But you're not going to have a friend. Second Corinthians 1:9, Paul says this, listen, we have the sentence of death, trusting in ourselves. We shouldn't trust ourselves anymore, but trust God only.
Yes, sir.
It's kind of like Equifax. Equifax lost its social security number, all the past jobs, all the past credit histories, everything on 143 million people.
Yes, they did.
Then Equifax, I tell you what you do. You call in, give us your present information. And if something happens, we're going to alert you. The man will see me and say, wait a minute, them the folk who lost your first information. You're going to call them and give them some more information. Help me now. Paul said, look, we want to mess us up. It's best not to trust us, but to trust God. I got to do it. When we look at this world we're in now, glory, hallelujah. We got to ask the question, is it reasonable to trust God? When we look at this world that we're living in and all this mystery that we're in, should we not seek a friend in the midst of our misery? Because here's how Michael said it is. He said, the world is ruined. He said, things are just messed up or trumped up. He said, man has no comfort anywhere. Not out of his house, not even in his house. He said, there's universal corruption everywhere. Even in the pulpits.
Yes,
it's the most religious people will lie to you to feed their pockets.
All right.
I wish I had you this way. He said that that's just universal corruption from the White House to the Our House to the No House, all the way to the church. You used to come to church, and when somebody said, how you doing? They really meant
it.
If you can't even trust the folk at church and tell them how they're doing, a lot of times they're just trying to get something on you.
All right.
This is the world is messed up. It's not only the messed up, but the children are most disrespectful.
Yes, sir. Amen.
They don't care nothing about the parents. If you want to see it in action, go to Walmart.
That's it.
Just get your talk to the mamas any kind of way. No care nothing about mom. So this world is messed up, and the only way out is not to look out and not to look in, but to look up. It's the only way out of this misery is not to look out and start pointing at everybody else. It's that there ain't nothing here, nothing cheap, nothing pain, nothing. Then if you look in, how that is going to be worse.
Right.
But you know you better than you know them folks. Well, this is bad. So what you got to do, rather than looking out, looking in, look up. Yeah, it says messed up, I tell you. There's no fruit. So when you go to the vine, there's nothing there.
Well,
so there's no fellowship.
Well,
you don't know how to mingle with people.
Well,
so there's no fidelity. You can't trust nobody.
Yeah.
Oh, there's no foresight. You can't see where you're going. You don't know how to get there. And sure, there's no family. Not even the one you sleep with can be trusted. So then we must raise the question, can we be miserable and hopeful at the same time? I wish I had a witness here. I wish I had a witness here. They would say, yes. Huh? I had my grandmother here, she would tell you, yeah. I had to live in misery, but I had hope at the same time. Yeah. How did you have it, grandmother? Well, the scripture says, they that wait on the Lord shall renew their strength. They will not walk on evil wings. They will run and not get weary walking out with somebody to go with them. Wish somebody could go and try to say it again. When you read Michael, you're going to see he gives up on the world. He gives up on himself. But then he looks up. Glory, hallelujah. So when I examine the world, that's misery. When I look at me, that's misery. But when I look to God, I got hope. Now you got it, it's rolling. Your husband called on the weekends. He gets drunk, spent up all the money, want to fight all weekend. How you got hope? How you hang in there? How you make it from day to day without committing suicide? Well, the pastor told me, if I wait on the Lord. All of you two people here have done some waiting. All of you two people have done some waiting. Somebody know what I'm talking about. If you ever grew watermelons, you know when the watermelons stop getting bigger, that ain't the time to put it. A lot of folks don't know it. They see the watermelon get a certain size, they just gonna pull it by the side. Mm-hmm. No, you don't pull the watermelon when it's sitting still.
All right.
Cause something happened on the inside. You wait until the stem dry up. And you look around and see the stem dry up, you can break it off. Because the waiting period is long. Somebody, you know what it means to wait on the Lord. Look like ain't nothing happening. But what God do, he let you rise up above your trouble. You still have the trouble. You got the same old job and the same old enemies. You got the same spouse, the same children. They're giving you all kind of hell. But it ain't troubling you because God will let you rise up. Trouble.
Yes.
We can. Can I get a witness here?
Yes.
We can be miserable and have hope at the same time.
Yes, sir.
The truth is, you can take a quarter and block out the So, open one eye and put that quarter up to the next eye. And that little old quarter will block out the light of that great big sun.
Yeah, all right.
Just right.
So you don't focus on your misery.
That's right.
No, don't focus on your problem. Don't focus on what's wrong. Think about God and the solution. Even in the greatest storm, the sun is still shining. Yes, Lord. When hurting people turn to God to get salvation, they see the good in others. Yes, we do. You know that disrespectful tone going to destruction. If you don't believe me, you can just ask the prodigal son. When you turn to God, yes, you will. He'll make close friends for you. When you turn to God, yes, you will. He'll change your world. I wish I had some witnesses here. I'm going to try to say it one more time. Turn to
God. Yes, God.
The world will start changing. Yeah. You see, clowns, one of the things is wrong. People, yes, they do. Talking about us got to carry our mission. The truth is, God does not need a church with a mission. He needs a church to carry out his mission.
Yes,
I wish somebody could hear me. I'm going to try to say it one more time. And I'm going on believing. I'm going on to the seed. I've held you long enough. I got enough of your time, enough of your attention. But you see, churches are not changing the world now. Because they got their own mission, they set their own goals, their own purpose. They make up bylaws, constitution, mission statement, and forget about God's mission. And God's mission is to change the world. If we just take on His mission, everything. We just take on His mission. Be a salt of the earth. Be a light of the world. Everything will be all right. Then you, Brother Connor, will have a friend. The scripture said, what a friend we have in Jesus. All our sins and grief to bear.
Yeah.
What a privilege to carry everything
hey.
God in prayer.
Oh!
Yes, sir.
Oh!
Oh! Show the Lord to hear.